Sony language, there's nothing wrong with it, that's a societal thing. I'm sure you're all creative and liberal people, you shouldn't really, you know, be bothered about that. It's just colourful, isn't it? What Billy sort of said then about me, sort of what I'm going to talk about, he's absolutely bang on, I am. But again, just a couple of kind of provisos. Like, I usually hate these kinds of things where I have to come and show work, because I fucking hate showing work for lots of reasons. First reason is it's a little bit like confronting your abuser, you know, like you work on this, you'll know what I mean when I try and explain that. You work on this stuff, it kicks your ass for ages, and then you have to put it out in the world, and it's, you know, it's done, or you meet your deadline or whatever, and you've agonised over it for, you know, weeks, months, whatever, and then out it goes. The last thing you do when you finish the job is go, do you know what, I want to get that out again and have a look at it and talk about it. It's like, no, you want it to fuck off out of your life. It's done with, do you know what I mean? So I feel a little bit like that about work. The other thing as well is, like, I always remember, and I remember and I don't ever let myself forget, I think that's important to say, like, what I was like when I was in your kind of position, like, at uni, about to graduate or whatever. I studied down in Falmouth, down in Cornwall, so a bit like yourselves, really, a kind of an extreme. But we were lucky to have things like this happen on a Friday. And we have people come down who are in the design industry, all the creative industries. You know, we didn't just have designers, we had people doing all sorts of shit. And you'd sit in there and you'd look and you'd watch these talks. And it'd be some, usually a fucking white bloke, middle class, that likes fucking Eames chairs and whatever else, just sat there going, here's a project I did, click. Here's another project I did, click. Here's a project I did. Maybe a little anecdote that made you laugh, click. Here's somebody famous, click. And I just used to, it was great, but I used to come out of there thinking, I'm never going to be that fucking good. I want that person's life. But ultimately, what I got away from it was, that's the kind of standard that the creative industry takes. And then I looked at my own work, and I looked at myself, and I didn't see myself in those people, and I didn't kind of see my work looking like that or being like that. And it just used to fill me with anxiety, and I just used to think, I'm fucked, you know, I'm not going to get a job doing this, if that's what I've got to be like. And it just phoned me up and fucking cry, you know, that's what I used to do. So I kind of made a pact with myself at that point where I was just like, you know what, I'm not ever going to do that. If I ever, by some stroke of wild luck, get to be able to do things like this, I'm not just going to stand there and go, right, here's a project I did. Even though I'm going to, in a minute, go, yeah, but. Because I just think there's more to it than that, and there's a chasm. What I realise is there's a chasm between the people that you respect and you look up to, that are kind of senior figures within the industry, that have a kind of reputation and a name for themselves, that tend to do these kinds of things at conferences or come into unions and do it, and you miss this absolute wodge of fucking years that they have worked their way up, worked their way through, made mistakes, fucked up, tried things, got things wrong, got some things right, got some things really fucking lucky, right place, right time, and you miss all that story when all you look at is the work. So what I try to talk about is I try to lead you up to the work by doing a lot of this chatter, being as open as possible. I want you to think about what you want to ask me. Like, I'm here now, ask me now while I'm in the fucking room, rather than thinking, I should have asked him that. Like, you can ask me fucking anything you want. Like, my shoe size, do I like my popcorn salted or sweet, where is it? I don't care, anything. That's what I'm here for, and that's really what I genuinely believe in, that actually, I'm here in his service to you, because I know what it's like to be in your position. I won't ever let myself forget that. And I want to sort of try my best to leave, when I walk into the garden of the creative industries, is to fucking leave the gate open for people, not shut it, and expect people to get through it themselves. So there's the fucking evangelist shit over. Where's my clicker? So quick blind date, who I am, where I come from, there's my brew. So I run my own practice, Office of Craig. Guess why it's called that? But we are in Manchester. We are small. At the minute, there's only two of us, me and the dog. Bless her. She's a crucial part of the team. She welcomes people into the office. But, you know, I've had everything from six people to me on my own in my fucking kitchen or in my bedroom, you know, working away. And I've been, we've been doing it sort of just about 10 years or so. But before that, I worked at agencies. I initially worked in London because I was lied to by my tutors and said, you've got to go to London, there's fuck all elsewhere, nowhere, it's fucking nothing, dead zone. And then London, go to London, that's the only place you can have a good career. I believe that, I've never been to London other than on a fucking school trip to the Natural History Museum. So I shit myself and went there. And I got a job at an agency that I really respected and were like high on my list. I was really, really lucky. They were called The Partners, but they're now called fucking Super Bunyan or something. Design Bridge and Partners or something. They've been eaten up by a massive creative conglomerate that owns loads of agencies. And I went there and that had just started to happen, so it was miserable. And I hated it. And I hated being in London because I never saw my pals. You know, I don't know what the equivalent here would be, really. Somebody might have dealt with me in geography. But what it felt like to me was where I grew up in Barnsley, South Yorkshire, which is in between Leeds and Sheffield. And it was like me living there and then saying on a Friday night, hard week, I want to go for a pint with my pal or just meet, see my friend. It'd be like me booking to Manchester. Like, it takes you an hour and a half to get over the fucking city. It's like, for a pint, then you're going to go back. It's like, what's the point in that? So I never saw anybody. Got a drain pad to work every day. And the studio was not that good. And then I was fortunate enough that I'd done a placement at The Chase and I got a call from one of the directors, Lionel, and he said, have you got a job yet? And I said, well, I have. And he was like, oh. And I said, no, please. If you're going to offer me a job, I'll fucking bite your hand off. Get me out of here. Pull the ripcord, please, Lionel. And he did. And I went up to Manchester and I worked there at The Chase for a bit. And I worked there for about 2 years. Got bored of it a bit. I felt like I'd done a big agency. The Chase was quite big then. It had three offices in Preston, Manchester, London. The Partners was a big agency, and I thought, I want to try something small. And I literally then heard from the grapevine that one of the partners at another massive agency in Manchester, Love, was leaving to set up a small studio called Music. So I went there, and it was like three of us in a flat, just around this kitchen table for a long time, and then we grew that to 25. And I thought, I've fucking seen this film before, what am I doing? So I thought, right, and there was no one else I wanted to work for, so I thought, time to start my own thing. So that's a whistle-stop tour through my fucking bio, maybe. I'm also creative director of Rough Trade Books, which is the sister company to Rough Trade Records. You'll probably know the shops and that kind of stuff in London and all over the place. They're a kind of countercultural, pretty big deal really in culture and music. And we in the studio do everything for Rough Trade Books and a little bit for the record label every now and again. Which, you know, as Billy said, Jarvis is on that Rough Trade, so that's how that stuff kind of happens, but that's my kind of schizophrenic existence. I run a general design practice doing a bit of everything. It's not tied to a discipline because I wanted a rich and varied diet. I didn't just want to do branding for fucking breakfast, branding for dinner, branding for lunch, and all that shit. I've got them wrong way around, but you know, fuck that. You know, must be hungry today. All my analogies are going to be about food. But and we also do everything for Rough Trade, which is kind of like being in house. But not, so it's a bit of a weird one. But what I'm going to sort of talk about is the thing that people always, how do you say this without sounding like an absolute twat? If I have any kind of reputation in the industry, or if I'm known for anything, it's for work that I generally have done for myself. Whether that's a book or a project or an initiative or kind of just being, you know, a sweary dickhead. And I think a lot of people email. I think a lot, that's not mine by the way, so if all comes up on there, it didn't be. Just, you know. If all comes up on this one, it probably is me. But, the fuck am I talking about? Yourself, obviously. Right. So, that seems to be what I kind of garnered a reputation for, was kind of
this kind of what I would say is self-initiated work or kind of an authorial practice if you want to be an MA student about it. But it wasn't ever vanity. It was always, I was really interested in the dynamics of what it is to be a designer. I am a really, really reflective person. I read a lot about creativity, design, certainly used to, and I used to be really interested in a lot more about the mind and the preparation of what a designer is and does than I am necessarily moving shit around, you know, hairdressing kind of thing. I was never really bothered about that, and I'm not very good at that. I'm not a very good designer in that sense, but I do value my mind and I do value my approach and I value my process a lot more than I do what the fucking final thing looks like, which I think, in my view, is a kind of an ad break of a fuckload of a stream program. Anyway, so what I want to talk about is this, because I think it gets very, very mixed up when people think, that's graphic design, I want to do that. Because it is not, really. And I'm not trying to start a fight or give anyone a nosebleed, but graphic design is a commercial practice. It's something that works with commerce. It's inevitably and inexorably tied to capitalism. And it ultimately involves a client and an audience. And I'm talking really basic here because obviously there are different ways to do it, but fundamentally, that kind of commercial exchange happens with graphic design. You are in the middle of that process. And one of the biggest things I learned after graduating, when I was studying, I used to think that it was all about like being a good designer, being able to come up with ideas. And if the idea was good enough, then it'd go. Someone would buy it, someone would have it, it'd go out and it'd live in the world. But it ain't that at all. Because actually, you as a designer, you are there to translate a message from someone else to an audience, to their audience. And actually what you think about it, your personal view on it, on the work, sometimes doesn't matter. Like, it doesn't have to be liked by you for it to do the job it needs to do. So for it to work, you don't have to like it. And that for me was a pretty fucking long, arduous slog to sort of swallow. Because I just thought, well, what the fuck am I doing? Why does it matter? I could just be a puppet, you know, for these people. But it does matter, but it also, I think it's a real fucking concrete mixer of humble pie that you need to eat, really, to understand your practice. Because you are a part of a bigger process. It is not all about you. That's fucking vanity. So I'm not about that. Graphic design, as I said, is for others, to others. You have a client, or someone commissions you, or someone has an idea. You use your ability, use your creativity, use your tools, your processes, whatever the fuck it is, and then you give that to an intended audience. Now, that could be you, to myself, to me, but you're working in a vacuum. And I was really interested in that kind of dynamics. I thought, well, what happens if you chop one end off either side of that? Like, what happens if you don't have a client, but you still want to connect to an audience? Or what happens if the audience isn't there and it's a kind of insulated thing? And I was really interested in that, and that's where my kind of stuff comes out of, where my work kind of operates. So I always think it's really useful when you're doing this stuff, because I know that the closest thing that you probably have to do with this, I'm guessing, particularly, I don't know how you sort of structured, but I think at some point you will be asked to come up with your own briefs, you will be asked to self-initiate a brief, or at least fuck around with something that exists and find your own kind of outcomes for it, and have that kind of self-starting ability. And there's lots of things that I think I make a brilliant designer. First off, learn how to write, like write properly. Second off, but this is later, teach, that makes you better. And the other one is learn how to sort of self-edit, learn how to fucking self-start. Like, no, a lot of designers just behave like pets. They sort of sit over the fucking empty dog bowl, waiting for someone to fill it with a brief, and then they, oh yeah, yeah, let's do that. And then they sat around waiting on that, rather than keeping this kind of muscle active all the time. But it can stray into places that I don't, and I think this is a bit of my upbringing. Like, I can't do anything without a purpose. It has to have a fucking reason to it, otherwise I just think it's fluff. You know, it's just whatever. So I always ask myself these kinds of three things, like, why am I doing this? And this really did come out of my experience at the Chase, used to, when I was working there, obviously I worked within teams and I swapped around. They had little teams with like a kind of triangular hierarchical structure, creative director on top, minions below. That was like, and then there was, so there was like four or five triangles in this one structure. And you know, I hopped over ones, you know, whatever, around the place. And sometimes you'd be doing good work, sometimes you'd be doing dog shit. Sometimes you'd do stuff that was all right, sometimes you'd be doing something all right, but you'd be looking over there going, why are we doing that? You know, how come they get all fucking nice jobs? And all this kind of shit, politics and stuff. And I was going home and I was doing my own work, or I was doing my own work at weekends, and I was just putting it on a site that I wasn't telling anyone about, I was just sort of doing it. And I, in my kind of naive youth, I was thinking, oh, this is because I'm really creative. And I'm like, oh, I've got all these ideas and I'm dead fucking good at this, aren't I? You know, like being a twat. And thinking that's what it was. And actually what it really was, when I look back at it, is that I wasn't satisfied with the work I was doing there. So I was trying to find someplace else to do something that I was satisfied with. And I think it's really important that you find that out yourself. If you find, that's just one example of why you might self-start something. But for me, that is not enough. If you've never done something before, like if you've never learned a tool, or you've never learned a software, or never worked with someone else, like all those are valid reasons. If you just need the money, if it's freelance, that's absolutely fucking fine. But be honest with yourself about what it is and why you're doing it. Ownership, like, is it for me? Am I just doing it to, you know, scratch an itch? Is it for a new client that I want? Is it for a client that I've already got that I want to then sell in, which is a big chase thing? Or is it for an audience? Like, is it, have I seen something happen and I want to respond to that? Now, that could be a form of protest. That could be a gap in a kind of market, you know, and anything in between those two kinds of extremes. But you have to be honest about who it's for, otherwise why are you bothering? And all these things line up. And this one as well, like for me, is it worthwhile? Now, what I mean by this is, design for design's sake is fucking shit. Like, it's pointless. It really is. It doesn't work like that. For me, I mean, this is why I want you to think about questions, because you might be sat there going, fuck off, which is great if you are. I want to have a chat about this. These are all my opinions. I'm not right, and I'm not wrong. So let's talk about it. But I think design for design's sake is nothing. Everything I do, I kind of try and pass the mum test. So I phone my mum up and I try and describe something to her, or I send her something and then ask her to describe, tell me what it is. And if she gets it, it's like, well, maybe I'm onto something here. It's not that my mum's thick or, you know, whatever, but she's just not bothered. She's like, does it do a job? Does it do what I want it to? Do I like looking at it? What are her awareness and needs from good design are very, very, very different to mine. So I think it's good to get out of that kind of system. But I always ask myself, does the world need another fucking typeface? Really? Does it? Do we want to do one? I mean, I've done typefaces myself, I've fucking designed loads of them, I'll show you some in a bit. But does it? Can another one not do a job? Really? You know, what other stuff are you going to do? Like, does it need another poster? Does it need another whatever? This, that, the other? Certainly don't need another fucking company that's going to rip us all off, does it? But we lie to ourselves sometimes, and sometimes that's okay, sometimes it isn't, but it's worth asking yourself a question. So, one thing I'm going to show you, mainly books that I've done, because they kind of embody in the fullest sense what I'm talking about, really. And they are kind of me. I think it's only fair that if I'm up here spouting my opinions, that you see actually what I've done with those opinions, so you can make a fair judgment on whether I'm bullshitting or whether you think I'm actually true to what I believe in. But a friend of mine, Naresh, who, Naresh Ramchandani, he was a partner of Pentagram, he's now gone off on his own. And he's such an amazing, like, I mean, he's a guru, he's fucking brilliant, I love him. And he's one of the most rewarding kind of relationships I've ever had with a friend, you know. But he used to, the first time he introduced me to someone like he knew, I think it was a client or something like that. He said, I want you to meet these people, and we went out for a coffee. And he introduced me as, this is Craig, he's a writer. He thinks he's a designer, but he's a writer that can actually design. And I was fucking furious with him. I was just like, I'm a fucking designer. I went to fucking uni with this, mate. I got a fucking first. You're telling me I'm not a fucking... Anyway, I lost it. And he just laughed in my face. And he thought it was hilarious. And so he kept on doing it. And after I'd calmed down and the steam had stopped coming out of my ears, I, candidly think, well, does he have a point? You know, am I a designer that can write, or am I a writer that can design? Or does it even matter? But there's a bigger question here, and I think, again, this is about self-initiating your work. So if you're doing a project and you think, I'm going to do a book, and what I'm going to do this book on street art, stuff that I've seen around the street, whatever. If you go and take photos of that stuff, and then you lay it out, put it in a book, and then you print that book, that entire process you might think is graphic design, but actually when you look at it, there's at least three processes there. There's production, design, and photography. And if you like one of those more than another, or if you really enjoy the photos, but you fucking butt kick your ass, and then you just went, I'm not even doing the printing, I'm just going to send it off, or I'm just going to fucking PDF it, whatever. Like, you need to kind of look at yourself and say, well, what am I getting the excitement about here? Where's my creativity getting fulfilled? Is it actually in the designer? So don't, I think it's important to like not kid yourself if actually, like myself, I love writing. I really, really enjoy it. I've never sketched my ideas ever. I write them down. I always have. Like my notebook, you can come and look if you want, but it's literally just, I write the ideas. Like, it's a dog sat on the fence kind of shit. That's what my ideas look like. That's just how they come to me and out of me. Some people are really, really visual people, and they sketch them, and they might, but it's like you have to see and you have to break this down in order to sort of exist commercially with it to understand what you're going to get the most enjoyment out of, really. So I always think it's really healthy that I'm challenged on things like that, where I'm not just aimlessly thinking what I'm doing is actually design, and actually it might not be, and I might want to do something else. But the beautiful thing about what you're all doing is that graphic design is a fucking universe. Like, it's an entry point to anything you might ever want to do or transist to or move on to or even get surprised by and go, fucking hell, that's brilliant, let's go over there. Graphic design is full of that. So many people I know, and they're actually the best designers I know, are the people that aren't doing design anymore. Like, they've done it for a bit and then they've gone, do you know what, I worked with this chef and it was amazing and I loved it and now I'm training as a chef. I've got a friend who's a chef, I've got friends who's an architect, someone who's in fashion. But equally, I've got friends who are designers that worked in agencies because they thought that's what they had to do, and they've actually just gone in-house and they're working with a fashion designer, or they're working with an artist or a photographer, or they're working with a brand that they like and they're just doing that one thing all the time. And that's fine too. It's not about, I'm not trying to force my taste on you or my judgment on you. What you want to do with your fucking life is right for you. Fuck what anybody else says, that's the right thing to do. And how I learned all this wasn't actually from my work, really, when I look back at it. That's me nan and me grandad, neither are with us anymore. But Ron and Muriel, two of the best fucking grandparent names ever. But these two fuckers, like, taught me more about my creative process than any creative director I've ever had. And my granddad, he was a miner all his life, coal miner. You know, he went to Navy for a bit straight after school and travelled around. And then he just turned me fucking phone over because people have been dickheads and trying to get hold of me. And then he worked down the pit all his life. But I grew up with these two. Mum and dad split up when I was about five. And I was like, so when my mum was working as a nurse at weekends and stuff, I'd go and stay with my nan and granddad. This is my dad's mum and dad, by the way. Why the fuck, you don't need a fucking family tree. Who do you think you are? Welcome, Craig Oldham. Talking out of my ass, but I'll get there, stay with me. he was one of those people that could just fix stuff, like all the time. I don't know how the fuck he did it. You know, he'd have a drawer of shit in his kitchen. I'm sure everybody's got one of these. Pulp drawer, and it's fucking stuff, string, screws, carrier bags, fucking matches, keys, you don't know what they fucking open, all sorts of stuff. And you'd be trying to find something, you'd be losing your rag with your granddad, you'd be like, fucking hell, sort that out, and you'd be like, no, you never know. And then you'd see him fixing a cupboard door with some tape and a lucky band and a fucking coat hanger or something. And I used to look at him and watch him do this stuff. And it was always a workaround. It was never like beautiful. It wasn't, you know, like when he was fixing the car, it wasn't like he was a mechanic, do you know what I mean? He just used to fix stuff and he'd be like, that'll do, that'll sort it for now until we get it sorted by someone who knows what they're fucking doing. Mm-hmm. But he did it. And I used to think, that's so fucking creative, that. It's problem solving in its like most raw form. He don't care what it looks like, he just wants it to solve, he wants to find, think up a solution with what he's got to hand. If you can remember that program, Ready, Steady, Cook, like they get a carrier bag and they don't know what's in it, and it's like, right, make something from that, make a meal. It's like that, that's fucking brilliant, that's what it is. And I learned that from him. He'd just do it all the time. And you'd say to him, when I was older, I'd be like, Grandad, you know, that's really, really creative. And he'd be like, eh, what? You're talking about your dickhead, you know? And he did speak to me like that. He'd be like, stop being soft. You know that? It's not, what do you mean? I was like, and then you try and tell him, and you just like, it wasn't a label that he needed. He didn't need to be creative. He didn't need to be seen as being creative. He just did it. And I love that. I love the idea of it, that when you strip away all that kind of stuff, that hierarchy, the social structure of it, that actually you end up doing what you want to do with it, rather than and in a kind of pure form. And I love that. And my nan, who's completely fucking different, like, she, this was like the first project I ever did, like from beginning to end. I dibbled, you know, dabbed in on stuff, or finished that Craig, or fucking start that Craig, or whatever. Was a book, and it was at the church. It was on football poetry, and it was like I was there when we got the brief. I was in the client. We worked on it all the way through. So I got to print, and then I had it, and I was dead proud of it because it was like the first thing I'd ever done. So I was like, fuck, carrying it around, you know, like anyone. Oh, look at this! Look, fancy that? You know, have a look at this. How good am I? And I did it to my nan one day. Oh, nan, oh, this book's fallen out of my Bible up, nan. You might as well have a look at it. I did it. And she, you know, she's my nan, so she's like, oh, this is, oh, love, let's have a look. So she's looking at it. She's like, have you wrote this? You're like, no, nan. She's like, all right. She's like, have you drawn all these pictures? No, nan. She's like, have you took these photos? No, nan. She was like, and you could see her slowing down, like, oh. What did you do then? And I was like, well, it's a lovely typeface. Look at this wide space there now. That attention on that spread. Just shut it, put it down, and drop a cup of tea. And I was like, no. But, I was young, and at that point, I picked it up in a fucking rage, you know, like, fuck you. You don't know what good design is. You won't know if it fucking literally came under your nose like my book. She was absolutely right, absolutely bang on. And again, a bit like the Naresh thing. All she cared about was the book. Is this a good book? Like, and if she's in a shop, I can imagine the same thing happening. Like, am I going to part a tenner with this? For is it going to be good enough? What's it about? All that stuff. And I was just jumping straight to the design of it. And I think, again, the biggest lesson I learned from that was actually that it's about content. Like, if you haven't got anything good to work with as a designer, the best graphic designer in the world will not fucking save you. Like, if you've got nothing to say, it won't save you, because it's empty. It's a vessel. And sometimes you can do something really, really powerful with that, and sometimes you can't. Because if you haven't got the raw materials, if what comes out of that carrier bag at Ready, Steady, Cook's dog shit and biscuits, you're fucked. You're not going to win a Michelin star with that, are you? So, my nan taught me that. No one else. All the other designers I knew, including my bosses, including the people I looked up to, just cared about design. She didn't. And I thought, no, that's where I want to be. And I remember actually being at the Chase once. And it was like lunchtime, and someone had got a fucking, it's nice that up or whatever. And they were all designers were gathering around, like clucking, you know, oh, look at this, isn't it fucking lovely? Why aren't we doing that? You know, all this kind of stuff. And I remember being a backer, like, ooh, what are we doing? What are we looking at? And I thought, oh, I fucking hate that. But everybody else loved it. And I was like, I think it's really shit. But I didn't say all. And I got really kind of introspective, you know, like movie star. Why do I think it's shit? Oh no, what's wrong with me? And actually, it wasn't that it was bad. It wasn't a shit piece of design. It wasn't a good piece of design. It just wasn't stuff that I appreciated. My values weren't there. And this is all happening over years and years and years. But, you know, this is Barnsley, where I'm from. This is the market, or was the market, council have since fucking bulldozed it and built a tin shed on it. But I used to go here with my granddad on a Saturday morning, and I used to love this. Obviously, it's a sweet stall. I'm a kid, so fucking yeah, of course the sweet stall is my favourite stall. But I used to love the market. At the time, I used to love it because you used to go there and you get sweets and toys. And then as you grew up and you became a teenager, you didn't want to be seen in the market because you were like, it's just where knockoff stuff is. Unless you were at the trendy bootleg music one where you used to get all the fucking knockoff rave tapes and shit. So there was a real like extreme thing happening. You'd be like in all that ice around corners, sort of hoping nobody saw you. Again, why am I telling you this shit? But what I look back on the market and what I miss about it is I miss all these people like shouting and singing about fruit and veg and flowers and whatever they're selling, you know, and they're like, all this three for a pound and this for that and all the other, and all the fluorescent signs everywhere that they'd hand drawn with black marker. And it was like a fucking assault, you know, when you went in there, you were like, fuck me. Like, so bright, so loud, but so full of personality. People knew each other, they were laughing and joking, and it was such a like spirited, buoyant place. And I look at my work and I see that in it, that kind of love for someone that's got a raw humanity to it like that, or that's fluorescent, because I seem to fucking like neon as well. But like this guy who ran this, he just used to dress up as a sailor. He's from fucking Yorkshire. He couldn't have got more like Emmerdale than anyone. But he used to talk to you like you were a pirate. And he had like, you know, like one of those fancy dress, like wide captain's hats on. And you'd be like, this don't hurt me. What the fuck? But it was just like, but it was like a thing. And it's still a creative act. And I didn't appreciate it at the time, even though it made me laugh as a kid. Like you go back and you just think, imagine that being your business. And doing that, and I thought there's something fucking lovely about that. I also, this is Barnsley Football Club. I used to watch them lose every weekend. And football's the same. Like when I went to Falmouth in Cornwall, Cornwall in general is like there's a nuclear bomb that's gone off, and the only thing it hurt was people who like football. No, there's no fucking football teams there. There's fucking nothing. The nearest one's like Plymouth in Devon, another county along. And I went down to Falmouth in my trackies and my fucking whatever, and took my football boots and thought I'm gonna, you know, this town in Barnsley, no one knew what a designer was. No one knew what the creative industries were. They all worked in NHS or down coal mine or in associated industries around that. It was all very industrial. And there's me, like, I want to go to art school. And no one really kind of understood that. So I thought going to uni was me like finding my people, you know, like, yes, they're all gonna get me. And I went there and I felt even worse. I felt even more alienated because they were all into fucking skateboarding and surfing, and they were all from like London and Bristol and metropolitan kind of places. And I'm from arse end of Yorkshire. And they knew like loads of references. They had like dads who were in the creative industry. Oh, my dad works in advertising. My dad did the fucking Mr. Soft advert or whatever. And I'd be like, oh, who are these people? I didn't see myself in it. I talked completely weird to them. Like, they used to make me repeat myself, like parrot what I said, because I've got this thick Yorkshire accent. And they're all like, whatever. So I felt even worse when I went there. And I missed football, because what I loved about football was, again, this, you go to this collective experience. The football was fucking awful. And it was a real slog to get through a match of it. But all these different people have come together that did different jobs, that had different personalities, different principles, values, whatever, and then they'd all kind of collectively swell together. But the creativity in the place, I mean, it's obviously where I learned to swear. And something had happened in front of them on the fucking grass. And within 90 seconds, someone had made a song about it. And then you could see someone get right upwards, and then the fucking thousands of them would be singing that song that had just been invented 90 seconds ago. And I used to think, how the fuck does that happen? Who thinks that up in their mind? Like, but again, it's like this creative thing. Or they turn up with like bed sheets, spray paint and stuff because they hated someone on the team, or they hated who owned their own club or whatever. T-shirts they made, what they had written on the back of the shirts. It was all just these expressions. Creative expressions that they did. Now they didn't see it as that, it was just part of that kind of culture, that visual culture. And I loved that, but again, I went to uni, and it's like nobody played football, nobody got anything I was talking about. I couldn't like football, no, I couldn't get anybody to go watch a match in it. And again, like the market, I'd sit in the back of the one fucking pub in the entire town that put it on for me, to watch it, and I sit it back on my own, and it was fucking shit. And then obviously as I went through, I managed to persuade people to come and watch it with me, or at least just, I'll buy you a drink, come and sit with me, so I don't look like a fucking idiot on my own. And I think there's value in that. Now it's fucking trendy to be a designer and like football, but trust me, fucking weren't when I was. You know, Rick's the same with Bolton, like, all that shit. It's like, I went through that. And my mum and dad, like, before I went to uni, as I said, mum and dad got divorced. My dad used to love records, and he'd buy them every fucking weekend. And he used to buy, like, one that he sort of liked in charts or whatever that was out, and then he'd find one and let it speak to him, you know, that kind of fucking shit. Don't judge the records by it, fucking. So, and then they split up, and my mum like held his record collection hostage, like part of the divorce. So I knew my dad had some fucking belters up in the attic, and I thought I'm going up there and I'm getting them on fucking eBay, get some beer vouchers for uni. And I found these 7 inches that my mum and dad, they'd obviously played these records so much that the sleeves had just fallen to bits. So they made their own out of like wallpaper and ruled paper, and just staple them together, or sellotape them, or carrier bags from shops, paper bags. And my dad had loads of Beatles records that were on the Apple label, and he put them all in fruit bags. And I remember being sat there with these things around me, and I remember thinking, fucking hell, he's amazing. And I confronted my dad about it. I took him a few of these ones. I said, like, that's really lovely that you put the apple in the fruit bag, you know, like, visual pun. And he was just like, what, Beth, what? Don't want my fucking record scratching. Well, I can't listen to it then, can I? You know, and he didn't recognise it as an idea, let's say, or as a creative act. And going back to the cowering over the, you know, around the computer looking at it's nice that, I wanted to see this. I didn't really want to see the Tate's new fucking logo or fuck no, ooh, so-and-so's rebranded, like, how come? Fuck, like, but I love that people do this kind of stuff in their own world and don't need to walk around with on a t-shirt going, look at me, how fucking creative I am, you know, look, I'm on a blog. They just did it, and I thought that's where, for me, the real value is. And that's so, before I show you some pictures, like, all of this shit I'm talking about basically means this, so I could have saved you a lot of fucking time and effort, couldn't I? But, like, you, for yourself, define it. Don't let anybody else tell you what it is. So somebody, when I know what it's like someone you respect, or let's say your tutor comes on and says, oh, that's really good. Now, you might think, oh, fuck, that's great, a bit of validation. I feel good about it. Someone else does. And you move on with it. Sometimes you might think, oh, I don't like this. I'm not quite feeling it. And then someone comes over and says, oh, that's really good. And then you have that conflict in yourself, and you're like, well, I don't think it is. Or whatever. And it comes the other way as well, so what you think is really good, someone else thinks isn't. You have to decide what that is for yourself. Now, good design there, you have to break that up for yourself, like, because they're two separate things. So what's good, for example, that's a fucking task in itself. And do you mean, like, good as in it's creative? Do you mean good as in it does good? Like, is it a moral and ethical thing? You know, is it not harming the environment? Is that part of it? What is good? You know, does good solve problems? Is good for lots of people, not just a little group of people, or does that not matter? All of these things, you have to fucking decide that what it is. And then separately, fucking away from all that, what design is. Like, is it commercial? Is it, you know, are you a tool? Is your opinion, is it about having a style? Like, all of these things, you have to decide what that is for yourself. And then you have to put them together and figure that out for yourself as well. Because ultimately that will then give you an outline of what it is that you're trying to do, what you're aiming for, or even like who does that in the industry. You'll be able to instantly, half the fucking lot of them can get to fuck because they don't fit your kind of parameters of what good design is. But there will be people who do, and they're the ones you should go and look at, talk to, get advice from, get feedback from, try and work with. That's why it's really important, like right now for you. But long term, this is the thing that makes you happy, doing the stuff that you want to do. So if you don't do it, you're stumbling around in the dark. And another reason why I say this is that a lot of designers that I know aren't actually that creative. by my parameter. There's a lot of them that think that they are, and they're not. And they think that actually they're the only one, they have some sort of, what's the word? They have some sort of divine right to be the ones that come up with ideas. And if they've come up with it, someone who isn't the designer comes up with an idea, they feel instantly, well, our mind's better than theirs because I'm a designer. And that is the most fucking arrogant, fucking, I've got to boil over here. What a twat you must be if you feel like that. That just because you've done that, and you are who you are, you're better than someone else. Put that in any other fucking context, you're a dickhead. And it's the same now, so don't ever be of the opinion, in my opinion, that just because you're a designer means you're better at design than someone else. Just because you're creative doesn't mean you can have a better idea than someone else. And trust me, be open to anyone having a good idea, because everyone has ideas all the fucking time. And you can take that. And there is a moment for you. You can have a space where you then go, I am a designer. This might not be my idea, or I might have been involved in this idea, but I am a designer and I can now use my skills to make this better, to put this somewhere else. That's what good design is for me, that does it. You're part of something else. And, you know, to do good, anybody can do that as well. And sometimes the best ideas and the most creative ideas that are good can come from anywhere, and you've got to be open-minded to that, I believe. And I think you will get better from being receptive to it. Because otherwise, if you brick yourself up and wall yourself off, then nothing, if nothing comes in, what's coming out? So this is a posh philosophical quote from a French philosopher who died like 3,000 years ago or something, that I used to make myself look more clever than I am. But it really chimed with me when I found it. Because I thought, that's it, that's my practice. That's what I do. I don't create the stuff, I just pull it together. And I'm happy with that. Because actually what pulls it together is my point of view. That's where I come in. Like, my thing is the cord that binds the flowers. The flowers aren't mine, I didn't grow them, I didn't fucking design them, whatever. But I made that bouquet, there can't be another bouquet like it, because I've assembled it. And when you think about it in graphic design terms, I should just leave this open, because I'm going to be thirsty. But, you know, you supply the illustration, you supply the photography, you don't make it, you don't publish it, you might not even develop the website, you might, or the app, or print the fucking thing. Like, so it's always a collaboration. You always rely on someone else. So you are ultimately, you know, you don't write the words a lot of the time. You're giving all that stuff together, and you have to use your skills to assemble that. And it's your principles and your values and your kind of ideas and your opinions that will form the design and your ability. They will form it. That's you. That's who you are. You hold all that shit together. And that's such a privileged position. And like I say, you are part of a bigger whole. Like, if you think about it politically, and we're going to get fucking political in a minute, by the way. So if you're a Tory, fucking do one. I don't give a fuck, I'm going home after this. So, okay, I'm going to Tory bash, but you have to form all that stuff, and it's your opinion. But as a political example, someone getting elected, Barack Obama, right? Someone we can generally, you know, there are worse politicians in the world, let's say, particularly in America. But a lot of people, Barack Obama got elected. There was an amazing fucking poster that was done for Barack Obama by Shepherd Fairey. We probably all know it. It just said hope underneath it. Two colour image of him. Now, that poster didn't get him fucking elected, did it? But it played a fucking big part in it. And that's what design is, that's the power of it. If you accept that role, you can play a massive part in a bigger thing happening. But if you think that it's only about your thing, just when you say it out loud like that, it sounds so fucking childish to me. Like, why did it not be like my poster? So, because we're about a bigger thing. Football's the same. I've worked with loads of football clubs, and, you know, a lot of the viewers, well, as long as it's fucking red, or whatever colour that the team plays, it'd be fine. Don't matter what it looks like. And to be fair, like 85% of it is fucking true. They don't give a fuck. Because it transcends all that stuff. You know, that's why so many football badges look like shit. Even the new ones. Anyway, We're going off. So I'm going to proof it put in. I'm going to show you a couple of projects now. I'm going to whiz through these ones and then I'm going to talk about the one that actually was the first one that did all this. Because all this stuff that I've been talking to about, it wasn't that I didn't just like come up with it. It weren't just like there. I've not always fought like this. I've not always felt like this. It's taken years of me fucking up, failing, being really, really like fed up with work and like not fulfilled and thinking, fucking hell, like I thought this was going to be it. I really wanted to be a designer and I'm really unhappy. Like, why am I unhappy? I'm doing what I want to do. And there are fucking worse jobs, don't get me wrong, it's piss easy. My brother-in-law's a fucking electrician and he came and fitted an alarm once in our office and he's fucking there with his dad. And I'm sat at my fucking whatever, at my desk. And he just went, Craig. And I'm like, what? He's like, this is what you do all day. You sit at your computer and listen to music. It's like, yeah, I guess so. He's like, fucking hell. Fucking, anyway, pissed off. So, you know, could be worse. But all that stuff, it amalgamates. And when I left and started my own thing, I was like, right, I can't say all those things in other people's structures and exist in other people's systems and then set up my own exactly like it. Like, I have to do something about this and I have to start practicing, no matter how painful it is or how hard it might be. And these are projects that have sort of come from that. So the Epiphany Editions, a quick whiz through, it's a bit hard. Is it hard to describe? So I love film. Like, I absolutely adore all kinds of films. And I also love books. So one idea I had some random night, fucking years ago, I thought, wouldn't it be interesting to have a book that doesn't exist from one of these films and make it a real thing? So that's what I did, and I'm doing. So with all of these books, so I don't know if you know any of these films. This is Mandy, which came out in 2018 with Nicolas Cage. Fucking brilliant. If you haven't seen it, you're lucky, because there's a whole world about to open. The Shining, which you've probably seen bits of, Mean to Fuck, Donnie Darko and Beetlejuice. They're just four of them. There's others that we've done and whatever else. But in every single one of these films, even though they're kind of decades apart, there's a book or an artifact or an object in it that doesn't exist in the real world. It's only in that film. And the entire film pivots when this thing appears. Which ones have you seen? Any of them? None of them? Beetlejuice. Come on, let's do a hands up thing. Let's like pretend we're at school. Who's seen Beetlejuice? All right, that's pretty good. Donnie Darko? More? Shining? Even more. Mandy, fucking Donnie. Hey, my man. Young Bill, right, us three after. Fine. Here we go. Right, so in The Shining then, since most of you have seen that. That film, and I'll talk about this because I'm going to show you, because I've done The Shining. Like, it operates as it operates. You've got Jack slowly losing control over there. Danny's pissing about his trike all the way through the film, and Wendy's trying to hold that family unit together. And it's not until she walks in, all this stuff's happening that she can't explain, and she wants to ignore it. And then she finds that manuscript, and it just says, all work, no play, Mr. Jack, a dull boy, over and over and over again. And it's at that point that the whole film shifts, and it becomes violent. And then you absolutely cascade into the madness, if that's how you see it. But that prop does that. It is the catalyst. It is the epiphany. In Beetlejuice, they don't really know they're dead until they turn around and see the book. And then that book guides them through that entire film. Donnie Darko, it's the same thing. He doesn't really understand that kind of tangent universe thing that's going on until he reads that book, finds it, connects it all up with all the characters that are involved, finds out he's kind of the Jesus person, whatever. And in Mandy, it's much more ambiguous. And I won't talk about it because half of you have seen it. But Dabber. So the first one we did with this was called a film called They Live. And what the idea with these books is however they exist in the film, that's how they're going to exist when I make them. And then, so everything you see is replicated to 100% the best we can. And then we hop, skip and a jump with a bit of creative license to fulfill the rest of the book, which is ultimately a critique on the culture which made them. So all the things these films drew on to get made, all the references, all the inspirations, we talk about them, and then we look at what happened after the film and all the inspirations, and we draw people in from cultural disciplines like art, music, whatever fashion, to wade in on the film itself. So They Live, who's seen They Live by John Carpenter? Fuck, you're my people, aren't you? Like, this, if, again, you should watch this because it is brilliant. So it's from the 80s. John Carpenter, the guy who did like The Thing, Halloween, Escape from New York, so many other good ones, Big Trouble in Little China, what a film. But he did They Live, and it's his most political film. And what happens in this film is, because it's like a bullshit B-movie alien invasion number, there's a wrestler in it, like pre-rock years, and he's bumbling around. The whole world is getting more extreme in terms of poverty, those who have and those who have not. And he stumbles across a resistance, and they're making sunglasses. And when you put the sunglasses on, you see the truth. And it's all colour. They put the sunglasses on, everything goes black and white. It's like a reverse Wizard of Oz. And this is what you see when you're wearing the glasses. You see that all forms of media are controlling commands set up by an alien race that are trying to control us and use us as cattle to feed off us. And he puts the glasses on and he sees this book, this magazine on a stand, and picks it up. And it's the first time he sort of does this, takes him off, he sees this, obeys on the cover, he sees buy, consume, marry and reproduce. He takes him off and it just looks like a normal magazine. Puts him back on again and he sees one of the aliens, and then the whole film completely changes. So we replicated that. This is my book cover. And inside the whole, we've got those replica pages that you see, we found the original prop, we replicated that within the thing. And then we hop, skip and a jump. So the whole book sort of flips from colour to black and white, from sort of high gloss to not. This is a spread from the actual one in the film that we've replicated as well. And then inside we invited Shepard Fairey, who did, got Obey from this film, that's where he nicked it from. He wrote a piece of the book. John Grant, the musician, he wrote a piece about John Carpenter's scores because he makes his own music. Slavoj Žižek, the spitting philosopher, He wrote a piece on, there's an amazing fight in it that lasts like 20 minutes. It was just between two people, it's agonising. South Park recreated it, which is fucking funny. Brandalism are in there as well, who kind of do this stuff as a practice. They take ads out of existing spaces and put their own adverts in. We talk to them because I know the guys. That's one of the aliens there, that's what they look like in the film. And the whole book is basically a thing. John Carpenter wrote the foreword for it. And I wrote pieces that I thought were interesting themes about it, like all John Carpenter's films have strong female leads, if not like characters, and the whole thing is a piss taker, like the action hero in the 80s, you know, Arnold fucking Schwarzenegger and Sylvester Stallone, who, and this is the best description that I've ever heard in my life for anything, looked like, let me get this right, a condom stuffed with hazelnuts. I mean, Arnie at the time, there's a vision for you. I looked at all the politics. It's about Reaganism, Thatcherism, consumerism, capitalism. These are all kind of archive stuff that use that material. These are some stills from the film. We also printed the whole thing with invisible inks and subliminal inks and ghost inks, so that there's messages in there that you can't quite read, or you catch them at certain times in certain lights. So there's lots of, you can't really see it, you can kind of see a little bit of the letters there. But they just sort of clear gloss throughout it, and the book was printed with a scented ink, so it smells like bubblegum. And be honest with you, it's like a drink for you.
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass.
So it smells like bubblegum because of that. We found all these books behind them as well. We found all of those and put them in the book and whatever else. Just sort of give it a fully rounded kind of articulation of what it is, a celebration of that film. So that was the first one. The second one was The Shining. And this is the lid for it. Now, you never see any, you see the box, but you never see a lid. So we had a bit of artistic license with that. But this is, the whole book is a book within a box. So this here that holds it all, this tray, is an exact replica. I went to the Kubrick archive and looked at the actual prop, measured it, got the materials from it, even found the paper that they used, which was a script paper. And that's kind of, we recreated it from there. This is, there's no binding in this at all whatsoever. Nothing is bound, it's all completely loose because that's how the typewriter sheet is. And I really like the idea that you could fucking drop this on floor and it's scattered everywhere and then pick it up together, but it can still read. Like, there's no page numbers in there, there's no order to it. The whole thing can be completely reassembled and edited and read in any way you want it to. Because the film itself, if you've seen it, is a complete, it's not a complete mystery, it's just that you can read it in any way you want and it will work that way for you. It's such a kind of marvellous piece of cinema for that. I got the typewriter that Jack used, not the actual one, but the same model that was available. We found a not really old copy of it. And I punched at different kind of pressures, like really soft to really backing, you know, hard, all the characters that are on the typewriter. We scanned them in. A typographer friend of mine made a typeface out with some coding in it, so it replicated a typewriter when you use it digitally. And we could also go in there, and if we wanted one word to be bold, we could use the heavier weights, light. So it's got this kind of, it's the exact same typography that was in there. The whole thing, the actual prop in the film, was typed by his receptionist. And she typed the entire ream of paper at all word and all play. But she got really creative with it, and she was fucking mad, and it got really like concrete poetry and fucking great. So I just riffed with that as well. So we did that. All the contributing pieces, so Gavin Turk's in this, the artist, Margaret Howell, the fashion designer, Cozy Fanny Tutti. Cozy Fanny Tutti's a musician and an artist, and she talks about domestic abuse and domestic violence, which is a big theme of The Shining. So it's about platforming views. About 80% of the entire content was from female contributors or people from the LGBTQ plus community, because they never, in all the wads of shit that's written about Kubrick and The Shining, it's all fucking blokes, white blokes, telling everybody what to think. So I use this as an opportunity to try and, in a little way, recorrect that. But they're on these black gloss, loose leaf publications, which replicate the kind of title cards that jump through the film. Like it says, Tuesday, Saturday, whatever. Margaret Howell, she designed Jack's jacket that he wears in the film, so we interviewed her. There's these picture books which are replicating the title sequence, which is like this weird neon blue. And these are where all the images are for it. We even went stupidly insane. I watched the film endlessly, obviously, with my research, but I started looking at what was on the hotel walls, and we tracked down all the paintings and stuff. So there's an entire booklet in there just of art that's in the hotel. There's a scrapbook in there, because there's a scrapbook that goes missing in the film. The lid is printed on flock, so it feels like carpet with that design. It's got a keyring in it from room 257, and that's that. So, but the whole idea with these film books is not just to be like, oh, Craig likes film. It's actually cultural commentary on what these films are and what they do. And like I said, giving a different voice and a different look on film criticism, talking about films differently, talking about what films can actually do or be or mean to people. Like the fact that artists might watch a film and then make a piece of work, or that a musician might score it based on other things, and all these kinds of different disciplines have come together to make film. I'm really fascinated by that, because film is like a really unique discipline that it needs every creative discipline to work. It needs designers, it needs interiors, it needs fucking people that are really good at woodwork, it needs fashion designers, it needs makeup designers, it needs hair, it needs sound, it needs video. All this stuff has to come together. And I'm fascinated by that, and those little moments that you, as a designer, but that I can learn from that. And that's what all these things are about. So the next one, Beetlejuice, that's coming out this year. And this is the one, really, because it's the 40th anniversary of the strike this week. And I'm going to talk about this one quickly. How long have I got, Bill? Am I running out of time?
No.
We're all right. If you get bored, just tell me. I'm not bored. So this was the book, really, that started all that stuff I was telling you about before I showed you the film stuff. This was the first project I did on my own when I was working for myself. So a bit of a background for you. This is in loving memory work. The one on the left, which has gone fucking weird for some reason, like that, is the first edition. This is the second edition, and there's a third edition which is out now, roughlybooks.com. And what this book is it was initially released for the 30th anniversary of the strike, so it's 10 years old now. And it was, as I said, the first thing I did. Now, as you know, I grew up in Barnsley, which was a mining town, which I said earlier. But all my family were miners. Like, Dad was a miner, Grandad was a miner, my great-grandad was a miner, and so on. They all worked down Barnsley coal mines. And my granddad and my dad were working in 1984 when a general strike was called, and they went out on strike in support of their trade union. And they stayed out of work for an entire year. And they were fighting Margaret Thatcher's Tory government, which is where the Tory bashing comes in, so get ready. So it was an industrial dispute where people were fighting to sort of not close pits, to stay in work. And there's so much written about this thing, the strike. Like, fuck tons about what it was, what it meant for us politically. Because it was massive, it was an entire year. We've seen train strikes, you've seen protests, but inevitably, what's happened, what we've seen, is they get solved in a couple of months. 12 months, people were out of work. And it's not in and out, yo-yoing. They were out of work for 12 months. My dad didn't get a wage for 12 months. And it was not just a national thing that happened, because there were pits all over the country, Scotland, around here, Yorkshire, Kent, Wales. They were fucking everywhere, and it was a big thing. And the coal, I think, it employed about 250,000 people at the time, and it was one of the biggest trade unions, well, it was the biggest trade union that we had. So it was a huge national thing, and international, because it brought in so many other countries as well. So it was a pretty seminal event. And I obviously had a personal interest in it. My dad and my granddad went out for work, but I'm actually called the strike then back home, because I was born in 1985. Dad's out of work, got no one else to do. I'm the fruit of that labour. So when the 30th anniversary came around 10 years ago, I wanted to do something on this. I didn't know what I wanted to do. I want to do a book. I just thought, I'd grown up seeing all this. As I say, I grew up after the strike had finished. So I grew up in this landscape where there weren't any jobs, where people were out of work, where people were depressed about that, where the town saw the high street shut in and people having to leave and go to other cities like Sheffield and Leeds for work, and you'd never see them anymore, and marriages break down like mine did, and families sort of feel all that tension. I grew up in that wake. And I used to, like you do when you're a kid, you think everybody has your upbringing. So I thought everybody grew up like that. And I thought everybody's fucking dad had a denim jacket covered in badges. And I thought everybody's granddad had a garage with fucking stickers all over it and posters up and whatever else. And I didn't think all of it. And then you grow up and you learn about the kind of reality of these things. But I saw stuff in this. Like I said, there'd been so much written about it politically, environmentally, you know, about coal, about socially what it meant, but no one had done anything about the creativity that happened during this strike. Like, people were facing incredible hardship for 12 months. Like I said, 12 months, if you think about it, I mean, it's a fucking long time to have no money, nothing coming in, and watch all these people struggle around you. But they still responded to that creatively. Like, they made things. Like, it's not just 2D stuff like stickers and posters and placards and banners and stuff that you'd expect in a kind of protest. They wrote songs, they wrote music, they made films, they took pictures, they performed in front of each other to raise money. They went and spoke at conferences. And no one had fucking said anything about this and the value of what was in that from working class communities. And the creative industries is full of middle class and upper class people. It's a fucking white, middle class boys playground. It's getting better, but it fucking definitely was that when I was in there. And it's not getting better quick enough. But I'm a white lad, but I wasn't middle class. I didn't know where a fucking Waitrose was for fucking years. Somebody once said, oh, it's like a Waitrose club card. I was like, what the fuck's that? Like Tesco, you mean, you know, what? fucking Asda. You know, I didn't know any of this shit. And I didn't know what a fucking Eames chair was, and I didn't know all this fancy furniture and all this shit that everybody around me seems to know. And I felt like, again, like I told you before, I felt like an alien. And this is the stuff that I come from. This is the kind of design. So I wanted to do a record of this. So it is an incredible personal project, but it's also made further political and further personal, because this is my dad getting arrested. And so this happened in June 1984 at a place called Orgreave. Now, Orgreave's a little tiny town in between Rotherham and Sheffield. So it's down the road, effectively. But what happened at Orgreave, miners were going to pickets. They were going to their own pits where they worked, and they were asking people not to cross the picket line. They weren't allowed out of their own county. The police would stop them, which is fucking wild when you think about it. Like, my dad couldn't get out of Yorkshire. Fucking mad. The Terrorism Act came on laws that they enforced during this dispute, that they made up during the strike. So, this is my dad. And what happened at Orgreave was, it was a pit. It wasn't a pit, it was a coking plant, which is where they turned coal into a thing called coke, and coke was then shipped to steel industries where they made steel, because it burns hotter and faster so they can melt metal with it, blah, blah, blah. And it all came out of there, and it was a crucial point, because they thought, if we could shut down other industries, like, all our power stations at the time were coal-powered, steel industry was coal-powered, they were coal, steel, and energy were the three biggest things that they had going. So they tried to stop those things going, because if they stop them happening, everyone else suddenly fucking gets pissed off. You know, if you can't put the lights on, who do you fucking blame? You need to get more coal, so the miners get back to work on their demands. So that was the plan. So they went there, but when they went there, instead of being stopped by police blockades, they were invited in. And when they got there, they were flanked on three sides by thousands of police officers in riot gear. In front of them, there was about 10 deep in riot gear with the helmet, the baton, and that long shield, plastic number. On that side, armoured police with dogs. On that side, armed police on horses. And they basically kettled them and beat the shit out of them all. And my dad was arrested there. And this is my dad's recollection. Obviously I wasn't there, but he was at the front of the push. They called it the push, like when the lorries were coming out, they'd try and get to him to form a line, stop them, and then go and chat to him. The police, like, they met the police. They used to link arms, you know, interlink, so that they were at a less breakable kind of line. And my dad said he felt a weight on one side after he saw a flash. And his mate basically had been hit over the head with a truncheon, and he collapsed on the floor. My dad knelt, brought the line, went down to pick him up, and they were both dragged through. His mate got pulled off somewhere else, unconscious, and he was arrested like this. And he was they took over an Asda down the road, and they just sat people in it. He was punched, he was kicked, he was spat on, he was pissed on by police, and he was charged with having an offensive weapon on him, which was his keys. And he was charged with unlawful assembly and riot. And the interesting thing about that is riot, no one had been charged with riot in our country for over 100 years because it's an ancient law, but it carries a life sentence. So he was up for a life sentence at court. And he went through court, and ultimately he was one of 95 miners where they were acquitted. His QC was Mike Mansfield, who's quite a big deal now. I mean, you might recognise him if you're into that stuff. He defended Stephen Lawrence's family, the Hillsborough families, the miners, and he got it thrown out of court because he proved that the police were lying. He proved that they doctored statements, so they all had been fed what to write on their notepads, which is illegal. Every policeman's supposed to get their own point of view, and they didn't. They fed that, and he was manipulated in the media, and it all got thrown out of court, thankfully. But he was 27 at that point. Like, he was the age I was when I was doing that book, and he was up for life with two kids already, because I'm the youngest of three, and me on the way. So it's a pretty fucking personal thing, this book. And the worst thing about it, which makes it more political and personal, is that they lost the strike, the miners, the government won. And they absolutely annihilated it. They annihilated them, and they changed everything. They closed all the pits. Within the 5 years, well, it was 5 to 7 years of this strike ending, there was no coal mining industry at all. There was like two pits left open and all that coal was exported. So it was fucked. And yeah, I wanted to just document this because someone from our side, let's say, all their words have been manipulated, the media didn't represent them properly, papers were all on the side of the government. There was 13 national tabloids at the time. 12 of those editors were all knighted in 1985 when the strike finished. Guess why? Because they towed the line. And yeah, another thing that's quite interesting about this, interesting in a really fucking horrible way, this photo, we found this by complete accident, by the way. We just found it on Google Images when I was looking for my dad. And he was like, that looks like me. And I thought, fuck off. Anyway, I tracked the image down, I bought it, it was a BBC image, I bought it, high res, and I phoned him up and I was looking at it and I was like, right, describe what you're wearing. And he did, to the point, and he told me this story about these fucking shoes. So he said, these shoes are my granddad's. And he said that my granddad didn't want him to go to Orgreen because he was like, it's going to kick off, don't go. But he went. And he also went in my granddad's shoes. And he said all of my dad remembers when he was getting lifted away was like clenching his toes really tight so his shoes didn't fall off. Because he was like more terrified of my granddad than he was pleased. But anyway, so what this photo, it's like weird that it's my dad, but also like the framing of it, like the composition of it is really interesting. This guy, fucking whatever he's doing there. But this dude here with the megaphone, he was the chief of police in South Yorkshire Police who would, after doing this and fabricating the statements and basically beating up and stitching up all the miners, then went and did it at Hillsborough. He's that policeman who was on the dock. So it's just like a pretty weirdly politically important picture. My dad just happens to be in. Because what happened at Hillsborough where 96 people lost their lives. It was the same police force 5 years later doing the same tactics. Lied on the statements, orchestrated it all, media campaigns, smearing the families. But they practiced it all green. Not one policeman has been disciplined for this. No one has been charged. No one has been corrected. No one's been sent on a fucking course. Nothing for this. And that's why this book has an added importance to it for me. But this also happened at Orgreave. This is a really famous picture. And this is Leslie Bolton. So Leslie was she's not from Sheffield. She lived in Sheffield at the time. She moved up there, but she's from London. And she was a photographer and she was doing some freelance for a newspaper. So Orgreave, where the plant was, it was at the bottom of a hill. And up the hill was the little village where everybody lived. The police charged everybody up that hill. And people were just fucking legging it to get away. She, as you can see here, She's behind a wall. She's in somebody's front garden. Because down here, there's a bloke whose head's split open and he's unconscious and pissing blood. And she's shouting to ambulances that are all lined up here. Now, why would they have ambulances there? Ask yourself. But they're all here. She's shouting, we need fucking help, get somebody over here. When she hears, and this is a quote from Leslie, I'll have you too, you bitch. And this is a policeman behind her. She's shot by a guy called John Harris. He's a documentary photographer, he's still doing it now. This kind of stuff is an absolute legend. But he got 3 shots of this. This is the first that went absolutely crackers. And there's another one where his arm's a bit further down. And then another where he finally just misses her. Because luckily, just there, kind of make it out. Her friend saw this happening and like span around. And he just missed her face. And she just said she felt like the wind go past her head. This is Tory Britain, folks, isn't it? Fucking hell. And what we're seeing now is as horrific. And the Met and all of that, they were all there, having the time of their lives, getting paid overtime, kicking the shit out of working people. So, but what happened with this, and I never have the language to describe this, but because I don't want to say it was a good thing. But what happened as a result of this was a creative kind of explosion happened. Because finally the miners who were getting this treatment, and it weren't just men, women were on the picket lines as well, and kids. They were getting treatment like this every single day. They were getting beat up by police and harassed by police and arrested for nothing by the police. But finally they had something like proof. And they went mad with it, like they fucking, like proper post-punk Britain, you know, photocopying it, screen printing, making posters, t-shirts, badges, fucking stickers, everything they could, saying, look what's happening to us. There was two fucking newspapers that printed this photo. Two. And it was fucking Labour Weekly, who fucking reads that? Other than people that read it and the fucking Socialist Worker, again. Preaching to the crowd, converted rather. So, but this was a kind of landmark thing. This poster you see on the left there was thrown into Parliament at the time. And this is what I want to document, because you don't see any of this in museums. You don't see this anywhere else. It was like one of the biggest things that happened in this country politically since the fucking World War. But it's not there. Why? Because it's been willfully ignored. But there's value in it, there's creative value in it, like what they did, their collages, their cut-ups, their communication, and that's what this book is about. This is a poster and a postcard that was done by, he was actually a designer called Paul Morton. He was working in Leeds at the time. He's from Barnsley. I should show you another thing, but this is a really good example to me of like why these things are important. And I talk a lot when I talk about this about layers. Like layers of communication and ideas that lace these things. Because you can look at that, and when you've got your head on, like, oh, it's a protest, it looks protesty, and you can kind of leave it at that. Now that's fine, that's just one layer to it though. But V for Victory is a Tory idea. It's Winston Churchill winning the war, giving the V sign. So he's subverting that, using red, it's a Labour colour, it's an official state photograph, so there's another choice there. And you can see suddenly all these decisions that he's made as a designer to try and communicate something to people. And yeah, it looks kind of violent and scrawly and of the people, because that's the kind of world and the audience is looking at. So there's value in that, and that's just one thing. This thing was going on for a fucking year. Can you imagine how much stuff there is? This was another one he did, which was a campaign to burn use more coal and electricity, peak time, burn more coal, but use more electricity. Burns more coal, they need more coal to replenish those stacks. But it's just a purely simple kind of graphic play. Smile in the mind kind of shit, you know. It's, you know, I'm not a big fan of smile in the mind, because it's like hitting people with a sledgehammer. Sometimes you need it, sometimes you don't. And this was a good one. Using the SOS, using the clock, all of that kind of stuff. Just works purely. But these are done by people that weren't designers. So this one here on the left, Pits and Perverts. Has anyone seen the film Pride? Yeah, can't believe you've seen them all, haven't you? This is the poster for the gig that happens at the end of the film. And it was just made by a bloke called Kev in the office. Mm-hmm. True story. Because he was the only one who could work with a fucking machine. And then he designed this beautifully, now iconic, kind of piece of imagery for the Lesbians and Gays Support the Miners community, which were a big unifying force at that time. Because they'd been treated like the miners had been treated for fucking years before. The police at them, aggravated assaults, you know, unwarranted the politics, you know, all the kind of clauses and stuff that the Tories brought in about your sexuality. They were getting persecuted, and then it started happening to the miners, and that's why these kinds of solidarity movements broke from this. But that's that. And this one was done by an unknown person. It was just in a walk-in screen printing workshop in Islington in London, where the person that ran it, he just said, if you come in, pay for your materials. He basically showed you how to work the machine and how to do it all, and you can make your own posters. Someone walked in off the street and did this, and he kept them. And this is after the strike, and it was basically when, shorthand, if you're in a dispute with your government, like if your government's at war, you're in a trade union or whatever, if you're arrested during that dispute, as long as you didn't murder somebody, you know, the general kind of crime census is you're released. There's an amnesty that happens afterwards. When it's resolved, because they realise it's an industrial dispute. You will, obviously, this is always the reason. None of the miners were released. They weren't. It took years of campaigning. Justice for Mine Workers was a massive movement. People were just locked up for protesting, and they couldn't get out of prison. And then they came out of prison, and they had an arrest record, which was supposed to be wiped, so they couldn't get another job. Not that they could get a job down the pit, because they'd close them all. Whoa, right. Get me going. But, and I'm going to finish on these two now, but there are two things in all this stuff, all this creativity, which was all acts of protest. Like, what I love about this work is actually what it meant for people and actually who it represents. when they're making it, because it's made by the people that it should be made by, and that's what I love about it. So out of the two things that happened during this horrible kind of thing, the two things I really appreciate is, one, what it did for women. So Women Against Pit Closures was founded during the strike, and a bunch of mines, wives and women from all kinds of communities, not just coalfield communities, came together and joined this. And this wasn't just about soup kitchens and collecting, which is what traditionally and patriarchally you'd view a woman's role within a dispute is. Feed everybody, you know, do some fundraising. But women were on picket lines. Women were doing the soup kitchens. And women were collecting. But they were also getting their fucking teeth knocked out. And they were also creating social structures that could work without wages for 12 months. They gave people legal advice. They stood up in front of people. They travelled internationally, some people. And they spoke in front of crowds of thousands of people when they'd never publicly spoken before, ever, in their lives. And I'm talking about people who had not any experience in this. They weren't trade unionists. They were people who, in what the structure was back then, and, you know, to some extent, you could probably recognise it now, the bloke went to work, the dad got the money in, the woman's role was to stay at home, wash clothes, tidy the house, look after the kids, cook the meals, do the shopping. That was their role. And then suddenly that patriarchal structure didn't work anymore because the men were out of work. And what Margaret Thatcher, ironically our first female Prime Minister, thought would happen would be that women, she thought that women would be key to this strike ending because she thought they would want that to stay the way. She thought they'd want to provide for their kids. They'd want money to do that. They'd want to buy nice clothes. They'd want to keep the house nice. And I'm so proud, so fucking proud, that she couldn't have been more wrong. Like, the women were like, no, fuck that. Let's get out there. Let's do this. Let's change it. And then that social structure evaporated. And they started campaigning. And that poster there on the left is like, absolutely fucking right on. Because she did really, really underestimate the women. And the joke, you know, the joke that I got told so many times by endless, countless men, even like my dad said this to me, and they were divorced by this point. He just said to me, I was like, what was the role of women like? He was like, oh, they're fucking legendary. The women were legendary. And my dad said to me, he said, I'd still be out on strike now if you were up to your mum. And it's like, that's what the women were like. The women didn't want it to go end like that. They didn't want it to go like that. But they were so creative. Like I said, they were teaching themselves about the legal system. They were teaching themselves about the benefit system, which had been changed. Margaret Thatcher did two things when she came to... I know this sounds like a fucking history lecture, I'm sorry. But I'm quite passionate about it. And it's happening right now. You might not see it, but it's happening right now. Again. And if we don't learn from it, we're all fucked. Not just me. She did two things when she came to power. Gave the police a 30% raise. And this is 1979. This is 4 years before this even kicked off. 5 years. She gave the police a raise and she changed the benefit system so if anybody went out on strike, they couldn't claim benefits. So you tell me she was thinking about the economy, my fucking ass she was. But the women were so creative as well, and this is the thing I love the most about them. Because again, we're going back to the creative industries, the museums lot, the people that would treasure this kind of stuff. If it's done by a famous designer that they like. But when it's done by some woman called Aggie, which is this, who did this, who's just from in Doncaster, in Armthorpe, a tiny little village, she founded her own chapter, Doncaster Women Against Pit Closures. She designed this banner. And it's like that icon, you know, it looks like trade union banners, I get that. But they have a kind of visual language that they all look within. So when you see a march, they all look of the same ilk. And there are some that are a bit weird, but she's building on that, she's using that. But that kind of iconic Women Against Pit Closures thing of those hands cradling the pit is beautiful enough. But what the institution's view on this stuff is that it's not really creative because it just looks like any other banner. But when it's done by someone who isn't what they would say educated in the creative industries, you know, they haven't got a design degree, they don't know what fucking design is, they can't then justify it. But this is someone who's just made this up. She's referencing the suffragettes there in the colours, you know, the purple, the green, the gold, the whites. That's suffragette colours. So that's not somebody who's just thick, that's someone who knows their history, their women's history. And they're building on it. And they did that. The women did that better than, and women's movements do this better than any in kind of history. They take what's happened before, what worked for women then, and they adapt it and they evolve it and they use it for now. a lot of the miners' groups, the women's groups, they went to Greenham Common, which was another massive anti-nuclear campaign against nuclear disarmament, sitting basically around a site that happened years before. They went there and asked them, how do you do it? What are you doing? What works for you? And they took what worked for them and they brought it into their own environment and they built that. And you know, this is Aggie referencing the suffragette. So these people, don't tell me these people are thick, that they don't know what they're doing, that they're just decorating, because they're not. And the other thing, besides from the women, is the humour. Like, they're getting hammered for a year and they can still laugh about it. They still make jokes. There's a stoicism, you know, like, I'd rather eat grass pie than go back to work, you know. Fuck it, if I ain't got any money, we'll make it happen. There's a spirit to it. And you can't get that unless you're involved in it. It has to come from the right place. So I always say to designers when they see this, you know, because they kind of feel like first ideas, you know, when you're thinking about something. But I said to designers, go on then, better that. What are you going to do? Set it in a fucking Helvetica. Ooh, kern it nicely. Fuck off. You're missing the point. You're missing the point. It loses the energy. It looks like that because it fucking should look like that. And it talks like that because it should talk like that. Because it embodies something more creatively than anything else that you would ever do if you weren't involved in that dispute. And that's what, and again, that's what I mean, that when you move away that client, you, audience thing, when that's not there, you can still make really meaningful work. And they did. And the writing of it as well, dig deep for the miners. And Colmont Dole, which is the ultimate one from this dispute, that is like, again, creative copywriting at its finest. Here's this incredibly complex political dispute. You can sum it up in three words. That's what copywriters, that's what we try and do every fucking day. How can we make this incredibly complicated thing a lot simpler so people get it? And they've been doing it. So there's value in it. There's value in it. And that's what the book is. So this is what the book looks like. And again, like me and all that shit I was talking about before, I like to feel all this is evidence here. So does the world need another typeface? Probably not, but it got one. This was a typeface we made for the first book because I wanted something that really carved up the chapters. And we found a placard from, there's a trade union for trade unions, believe it or not. And they had some really distinct typographic placards that we could never find. We only found photographs of them. So we traced what we could and we had enough DNA to then just make a kind of, you know, the letters, the characters for it, and then made that. And you can see it sort of in use there, and the headers up there, and these bits here. These are people that talked about protests and stuff, with any designers and people from the community. And any other typeface that's in there is only in there because it was around at the time. So there's a lot of typewriter in there, and there's a lot of stuff that you can get on Letraset because I didn't want it to feel alien. There's no point picking a typeface I like, because that's not the point. The reason it's a book was because it's from a generation before me where they believed that anything that was put in a book was absolutely truthful. You know, so that's why it's a book and not a film or whatever the fuck it could be. And yeah, I just wanted to show the artwork. And I say artworks with intent. This stuff, it should be treated like art for me. Because it's not. It's just bunged away in drawers in museums, if they've got it at all. If it's not rotting away in somebody's attic or in garage like mine would. Because it has value for us all, politically, socially, as people, but also as designers, and that's kind of what I wanted to do. The first book was printed using coal as well. We went back to a pit that my dad and my granddad worked down and got coal, and we ground it up and screen printed the first edition with it. We couldn't do that for the subsequent editions because I had to print more, and it absolutely fucking ragged the screens to death. We went through about three or four just doing 500, it was fucked. Because it's diamond, you put diamond through a thing, really. It's fucking cheese grater. But there's a story. So that's that book. And all of this stuff, the film stuff, this stuff, the stuff I do in my practice, it's not just me saying, this is what I'm interested in, you should be interested in as well. It's more than that. I see myself as a bigger part of something else, but I still have my own point of view. And if we just go fuck all that off and just go back to me as a designer, like, I work on these things and I try to put these things out because my values and my principles as a designer and how I make choices, create choices, not any other choices, like creative decisions, how I recognise what an idea is, or a good idea, or a bad idea, or where something needs to be developed into an idea, comes from all of this stuff. It comes from my background, it comes from how I was raised, and the people in the communities like this that raised me and did this. And for years, and fucking years, it was horrible. All that stuff I was telling you about at the beginning, like, I fought against that, because I thought I had to behave like a designer. Like, here are some designers I work with that don't look like me, talk like me, dress like me, they're not interested in the things I'm interested in, and I thought I had to be like that. Not like Bill, Bill was different. But that's what I thought I had to do. Like, I had to, oh, fucking hell. What do you mean I can't go to Greg's? I've got to go to Pret. Sounds fucking stupid, but I remember getting mocked in London for trying to find some damn line of burdock. Fucking, they were laughing with me. I had a little gaggle of them around me, like, look at this fucking hell. Say it, say damn line of burdock. And then they'd like laugh. So all that shit went on. And for years I thought, I have to assimilate, I have to be like that if I want to be creative, if I want to do my thing. And actually, the reality is it's the opposite ground. The creative industry, as I say, is riddled with problems, and it's institutionally fucked because it has been for so long a middle class white boys playground. And as I say, that is breaking down now. But if you are different, if you come from a different background, if you have a different experience altogether, that's not a bad thing. You should embrace that. Push that into your work. Push that into the industry. Because that's the thing that we all fucking need in the industry right now. It ain't be good at design. It ain't have good ideas. It ain't all that stuff like, oh, I have to do work like the agency wants me to do. It ain't that. If you're different than everyone else at the agency, fucking revel in it. Because that's important. Only you can have your own point of view, but you have to decide what your point of view is first, and that's what I'm getting at. Like, you have to decide all that stuff, and then you go out into the world with that. And you will find, it might be harder for some people, it might be easier for others, there's a lot of luck involved. But trust me, if you stick to those principles, you will find other people that agree with you or share them, and you can make better work, and you will be happier because of it. And it took me, like I said, like 10 odd years before I started to get into a place and do work like this, where I was actually happy. And that's my fault, because I was too busy trying to fucking pretend I was a designer. When I actually was a designer, I just didn't want to be like them. I didn't want to be a designer like that. Not wrong with that, it's just not where I am, or what I was, or where I come from. So if you've got that, embrace it. I don't know anything you don't. I can't have better ideas than you, but I'm confident in my ability, I'm confident in my opinions, and I'm prepared to stand up for them and say, I think this is good design, and that's what it means to me, and that's it. So you have to do that for yourself. That's all I wish for you, really. So this isn't a big, like, yeah, great, some nice fucking work, ain't it? Fuck that off. I'm just trying to say, hey, this is just what I think is good, and this is my version of it. You should be able to do this, and you should come and do this stuff. But when you do, tell other people that story. Don't just show me shit. So, yeah, that's me. I'm not going to talk about that, all that. There we go. Thank you. Not sure. But I do want questions.
Yeah.
Please. Okay. Yes, here we go. You were first.
The times when I felt like giving up and thought, why am I doing this? What motivated you to not just keep
coming
on and obviously get to where you are now?
Well, I still feel like that. I still have it every day, really. Like, still run into issues where I think, fucking hell, what am I doing? I still can't have any ideas, or still when I do have them, I think of shit. But it's a kind of a perseverance, really. It's like, it goes away. It does go away. You've just got to sort of stay the line with it. But I think the thing that I know helps me, and I'm not saying this will help you, but more for what it's worth here, is that I find it, particularly when I've got sort of creative block on, I feel like it's hard getting into a job or finding an idea in a job or whatever, is I have sort of having something else to go to. Now that might be another job, because I think there's some truth in that kind of idea of like, this is kicking my ass. Oh, fuck it, I'm just gonna leave it there. I'm gonna work on this that's maybe not as pressing, or maybe more, or I'll do that job first and then that. And I often find that things come from that process. I also find that sometimes just fucking off and doing the washing up or fucking going for a walk or saying, I'm not going to be a designer, I'm going to have a day off, I'm just going to watch a film and my pants on the sofa kind of thing. That is equally worthy. You're not being lazy. This kind of, this toxic productivity that is present in our kind of culture now, like you have to be busy, you have to be doing it. You've got a job, why have you got a fucking other job? You know, like, why have you got all that, what's the fucking word I hate?
Side hustle.
Yeah, that bollocks. Why have you got a side hustle? Why have you got a fucking little business that you've fucking got on Instagram? It's like, fuck off, one's enough. Do you know how hard this is? You're like, do you think I want to come home knackered and then do more work? Fuck, no, that's not me. Might be you, don't know, but I just think that's really kind of toxic, and I think actually sometimes the best thing to do is to stop or to even take a step back and just try and let all the stuff come to you, because sometimes you're too busy doing the job that you can't do the job properly. And it's just like stuff's got to come in for it to sort of get in your filing cabinet in your head, because you never know when your head's going to serve you up and go, ah, you remember that? So for me, it's about doing all the stuff and making sure that you do all the stuff. And I'm as bad as everyone else, to be honest, you know. I am a twat sometimes, and it's not because I feel like I'm good, but I am a twat for, like, I guess it's a form of self-harm, really. Like, I get home, and I'm like, I've got a laptop on the sofa, I'll just send that email. And then my wife, Ellen's like, put that fucking away. It's true, I try, but it's not good for me. I've never once had it work for me. I used to do it with the agencies, and there's another reason that made me really unhappy. I used to think I had to work late to, you know, show myself that I was there, first in, last out, all that kind of stuff. Don't get you anywhere. What gets you anywhere is just not knowing yourself and knowing what works. I'm dancing around your question, you know, so sorry, but I feel
like
that's
important. You know that it's ongoing, that you don't sort of overcome it and sort of learn to deal with it in
primary school. No, it's not at all. I get asked this all the time, not that question, but I get asked, like, what's it like starting your own thing? And do you worry about chasing invoices and when you're going to get your next job and, oh, fuck, can't see 2 weeks ahead of you? And I have those chats with people who are starting up or starting out, and I say, look, it hasn't gone away for me. I've not found it. It's not like it's the answer. It's like you just find a way to worry about it less. And I find that's the same thing. I still do worry about stuff all the time. It's not a day that goes past that I don't. Something. It's not like every time I wake up I go, oh, for fuck's sake. You know, but sometimes during the day, guaranteed at some point I'll just be like, I can't do this anymore. I want to work at Tesco. No, but you know, fuck this, you know. But I think I'd do that with any job. And I think that's the thing you kind of forget sometimes, like, because we're all passionate people, we all have our own ideas about, we want to get into this or we are doing this. You forget that it's just like any other job, really. It can just be that. And, you know, do you think, there's nothing wrong with, I'm just using Tesco for fucking example here, but, you know, there's nothing wrong with that at all. But do you think you go home from a Tesco shift thinking, didn't put that cereal box straight? Fuck, I will do that tomorrow. I will be employee of the month. It's just different because you have a different mentality when you approach it. So yeah, everybody's like that. If they tell you not, they're lying, fuck. Because everybody has that crippling anxiety of not knowing anything, they're anywhere. So yeah, you were next.
Yeah, so your book is incredible.
Which one? Kidding.
Did you always know that was a story you were going to tell?
No idea. No fucking idea. I actually can't, in a way I kind of, the mining one, we're going about mining one.
Yeah.
Being facetious, but actually I can't answer your question. The mining one, I kind of nicked that idea a little bit. Like, a friend of mine's a curator at an exhibition place in Barnsley. And I go and see him all the time because he's like the only cultural person in fucking Barnsley, you know. That's such a bad thing to say, but just for a joke, for a laugh, for a giggle, you know, I'd go and see him. What you got on? What's this? What's that? Look around the gallery. And I was saying to him, like, literally, like, what you got on? What you got coming up? But I was thinking maybe I could do an exhibition design and then get some work out of it, you know, a bit of that. And he said, oh, it's the 30th anniversary of Strike, we're probably going to do that. They got Jeremy Deller's Orgreave thing in, and that's where he got lined up for it. And I was like, fucking hell, is it 30 years? And he was like, yeah, yeah, it is. He was like, there's loads of stuff going off, and I just thought, it just like flooded back to me. And it was just like all the pieces were there, but he just sort of showed me the front of the jigsaw box, you know what I mean? That's what it's supposed to look like. And I just thought, all right, I should do something about that, because it actually, this, and this, and there's all this stuff were floating about, and I thought, I might try and pull those together. But I didn't know what I was doing, and I didn't know it was going to be a book, I didn't know who was going to be in it, I didn't know what format, I didn't know any of that shit. I just thought, maybe I should look at doing something about the strike, because it's important to me. And I felt it like a kick in the fucking teeth when he said it. Just like, yeah, I've not seen him anywhere for the last 30 years, so I should do something.
Anybody else?
I want an
open. Oh, fight!
Can we have a
fight? First one to land on wins.
I've got a practical question. Are
you theory or practice?
Theory.
Right, it's called practice then.
How did you finance it?
Myself.
Wow, okay.
Worked like an absolute dick for a while, and I've done other books in the past, which I've kind of saved a little bit of money, but it cost me about 10 grand to do the first book, and I cobbled to that, and I borrowed a little bit of money off my sister, about 2 grand off my sister, and just...
What's your sister's number?
I just sort of, hoped I wouldn't end up losing the house and going back to live with my mum. Right, that moment, every fucking day working on that as well, like, what am I doing this for? Nobody wants this book, it's just me. Fucking hell. Like, if this were any good, somebody had done it already. But they haven't. I was lucky. You know, I had a plan for that. It was a kind of calculated risk in that I thought, right, I'm going to try and get it in there, and I'm going to try and do this, and I'm going to make sure that I get copies to these people because they might write about it or post something about it. I'm going to do some launches because I think that's always better to do it in a captive audience thing rather than just like, hope people see the website. Like, I planned as much as I could to make sure I got it under as much people. And things with book is, I don't know many people who buy books just by looking at them online. I think they have to know about the book, or someone goes, it's been fucking good, this, you should find it. And that can happen, obviously, but a book like this, like, in many ways, the best way to sell it is to hear me talk about it. And then go, fuck yeah, let's have a bit of that. So that's what I tried to do, the launch in London, launch in Manchester, filled it as much as I could. And I sold loads then. But then they fucking went like wildfire, so I was lucky that I didn't lose it, but yeah, I did fund it myself. No publisher let me do that. Like, ooh, whoa, you've got the C word in here. What's going on there? I'm gonna can't publish that.
Last question, because I've got to take Craig for lunch and then go get a train.
Oh, come on, then let's get something of these.
So I once heard you say that you sort of struggled with your class. You said that the working class shower after work and the middle class shower before work. And I wondered, from your background being so working class and design being now a bit of a probably middle class, you know, where do you sit on at the moment? Do you perceive yourself as middle class, or do you still hold on to your working class?
I joke with this with my mates all the time. I'm a working class boy into middle class things. You know, I like a nice cup of coffee. I'm not those people. I might look like one. And I might be into some stuff, and you know, like there'll be certain flags that you sort of think, oh yeah, that's that. But then the similarities are close, but the differences are fucking chasms between that. Like my approach and my belief and my interpretation of design and things like that, they couldn't be more different to that when someone is a middle class kind of thing. I had this discussion yesterday about the design museum. Someone was saying to me, the design museum had been sniffing around us a bit to work with us. And I've been a bit like, I don't know if I want to. And like Eliza, our younger designer, she just graduated from Glasgow last year, she was like, why not, it's a fucking design museum. Like all that design in there. I was like, yeah, but I don't agree with half the stuff they got in there that they're saying, look at this, it's great. Because I was like, is design a 6 grand chair? Or a radio that some fucking old white German designed Apple copy. Apple, I fucking hate. Even though I'm held, like every fucking thing I've got, I'm trapped in an Apple prison up there. I hate them. I hate that dogma that only Apple, whatever they do is good, because they're Apple, and they put design first in their business. It's like, well, yeah, Dyson do that, and he's a Brexiteering fucking dick. So, you know, it's like, it's very different. And I think it's commodified by that middle class brigade. And they don't leave room for nuance, and they don't leave room for things to look not polished, you know. Which is why I'm saying that good design isn't simple. All that stuff that you see all over the place. Good design's this, good design's that. Fucking not. It's anything you want it to be. That's a very big difference. I'm sure you know when you met these people that have these dogmatic ways of being. I really don't, and I think that again is my upbringing. Because I was always taught, like, well, if you're not hurting anybody, don't matter if they're different. That middle class is about fitting in, hence why they're in the middle. So yeah. Any more from over there? Go on, mate.
Is or when will your Mandy book?
Is what?
Your Mandy book, will that be available?
It's in the queue, mate, to be honest, yeah. It'll be Beetlejuice. Beetlejuice, Donnie Darko, then Mandy, maybe. So it might be a few years, yeah. You see the size of that? It cost a fucking fortune to make that. I'm going for small books, mate.
Anybody else?
One more. Tyler. Back.
If you're in our shoes as someone who's about to graduate into the design industry, what would be your next step?
Well, I have been, so I can tell you. I can't, and this only worked for me, but I think it is still important because I'm always quite shocked. The best thing that you can ever do to give yourself a chance is to do internships and placements. Get paid for them. Don't take any of that shit, because that's wrong. But that for me was the best way to do it, because I wasn't the best designer. I'm not really a good one, but I know what I am good at. And when I was a student, there were far better portfolios in my class, you know, better designers than me in that room. But I felt that if you could put me in a studio, there were other things that I could probably do or be that actually go towards the job. And I would never have known that unless I'd done an internship. I didn't know what a graphic design studio, regardless of size or whatever they do for a living, I didn't know what they'd look like, what they were, how they operated. And actually when you get in there, it's a fucking workplace. Like, but you don't know that. You think you have whatever your idea is of what it is, like these ateliers or whatever, you know, that you think you just got your own view on stuff, and they're a lot more kind of industrial in that sense, like they're workplaces. And I recognised that when I got in there, that was the one thing I did. I thought, I know what this is about. I've had jobs before, I can work this, I can make myself indispensable. I might not have the best design, but I can fucking work on that. So for me, it's like, expose yourself to that as soon as you possibly can and get internships and get experience, because that will help you figure out a better start of how you want to go or where you want to go next, rather than just any job will do, or, you know, making mistakes that might knock your confidence a bit and your momentum a bit. I think they're really, really important. Yeah.
Okay, big round of applause. Thank you.
Thank you.